Before I'll tell you the topic of what I want to do today, because if I'll tell you, it might spoil a tiny bit what I want to show you in this position. So I'll show you this position. You're going to play white. I'm going to give you 2 minutes, the usual, right? I like to have you think. If I'll just sit here and speak non-stop, then it would be boring. If not for you, then definitely for me. So, white is to play here. This is a game by international master Jeremy Silman. Played against someone that I really do not know. But the idea in this position, I know, and I know this idea from maybe better players than Mr. Silman. So why to play here? Once we analyze this position a bit, we can discuss the idea. Whenever we have any ideas, suggestions, thoughts, anything in that direction, I'm all ears.
Bishop to c6, clearing the rook power.
Bishop where?
Bishop to c6.
f3 you mean, right?
Right, now, from my point of view.
f3. All right, bishop to f3. And then what? What's your plan? Okay.
I want to push that pawn against his queen and press that
e5. Okay, you want to play this move?
Preparing for the rooks, yes.
This move?
Yeah.
Okay, I do the absolute last thing, rook b8. My next move is going to be rook a8. So you show me a plan. Right? This is how I want to see a plan. You know, I tell my students, you know, okay, I do nothing what you do, so some of the smart ones, they will move the bishop back and they'll play here, 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 and take the queen. Okay, then I have to say, okay, without capturing.
I push the pawn against the queen as a d4. I'm going to go d4, push the pawn against the queen.
This is a blind
pawn. Yeah, I think you've said. Yeah. Okay. Yes. F4 and then go bishop there. All right. We are on to something. F4. Okay. But here, you know, I'm going to play something. What do you want to play? You told me, right? You want to play e5. So I have two moves that I can play. e5. I will play e5. And I can also play queen e5. But after I play e5, ugh, you cannot take. You are a pawn down, right? So let's just show it. I'll play e5. Yuck. So no, not this. But that's an idea. OK, it's not bad. It's an idea. Idea is not working.
Well, what I'm looking at is I'm looking at trying to get the knight on c4 or some piece on c4. So either knight e1 or bishop c4.
Okay, bishop c4. And what's the bishop going to do on c4?
Well, I mean, it's kind of a bad blockading piece. So that's why I was actually focusing on knight d1 and then knight d3.
Okay, I just want to hear one or two other thoughts, and then we'll speak about that.
Okay.
I mean, do we have any other thoughts here? So you also want to attack this queen, right?
And work on the d-file, which is probably the weakest right now.
Okay. So I think that the idea that we just heard before is pretty perfect, but only that it's not that I want something random on c4, right? The gentleman that suggested knight d1, yeah, that's perfect. I don't want a bishop on d4. What is the bishop going to do there? It's not that I say, all right, you know, I have to occupy this square, right? Just because I have to occupy this square. Knight c4 is... Knight to c4 is a brilliant idea. Brilliant, brilliant idea. And basically, this is what I want to show. We will have, well, 4 examples. If we will do them too quickly, we will think about more. But improving pieces, and actually all of them, this way or another, will revolve around improving knight spots. So yes, Grand International Master Jeremy Silman, that wrote some, in my view, amazing books, played knight b1.
Oh, b1. Okay. So actually, why is that better than
maybe there is no huge difference. I mean, maybe this path, for some reason, yeah. For example, I'll show you what can be the difference. But we are here first of all, seriously, to understand the idea. You know, we are average player, club players, little more, little less. Well, International Master Silman is a 2400 player, 2500 player. Our job is not to play exactly like him. But to your question, I think that part of the difference might be with the following continuation. Knight d1, I might play rook b8, for example. And after knight e3, I'll play b5.
Okay.
So we always say we have two big parts. Two. One, the idea. The second way is exactly how to get that idea working. The idea was perfect. Okay, now it's, the idea was perfect. Now it's a little bit the difference of level and so on, how to make it happen. So knight b1. Now, we will see. I can assure you one thing. It wasn't Jeremy Silman that invented this idea, and it wasn't many other players. He played it in an excellent way. He wrote about it in an excellent way. But we will see Karpov and Petrosian and some decent players. So what does he say? A shocking move that is very, you know, unnatural move, right? Moving back with your knight. But the big concept, the big concept is, where should this knight be? The knight on c3 is doing exactly nothing. He has no future from there. Black played queen f6. He's analyzing a bit some lines with knight f6, maybe a possible pawn sacrifice. Another, by the way, possibility is the following. The knight going from b1 has more flexibility after knight d6 did d2 exactly. And it's aiming possibly for f3. So it's much more available squares the knight gets. He gets d2 and he gets a3, as opposed to just e3. And by the way, the knight from e3 really only can go to c4, because g4 is impossible for him to go because of the bishop. So black played e6, and now I mean, white improved his position dramatically. The knight that was on c3 is now being replaced by the queen. The knight is now on d2, pretty much an ideal square. What's next? Knight c4. Well, first of all, if knight c4, maybe I can take on e4, right? Bishop c4. We will see them one by one. First of all, this, I think, not very okay, because f2 is hanging. Okay, if take on e5, take, and take on d5, right? So this is not. Bishop c4. Okay, bishop c4. I guess is a possible move. What will I play after bishop c4? White is probably better here. Maybe I'll just play bishop d7 or something like that. Nothing too dramatic. Just want to play b5 next move. Looks more or less reasonable. I'm somewhat worried about the idea of f4, by the way. I think it can be worth something. Oh, but maybe I'll take on c4. and on f4. But yeah, the bishop c4 is actually possible. If I want to play really too scary, I can take and maybe play this move. Well, this white is better, but this is okay, a bit scary approach. Yeah, a5. Maybe I can go here. But I agree, white might be better here. So if you want to play a5, Simon played bishop f1 and he said, it's just a lazy move. You know, just, okay, it's kind of a healthy move, putting the rook on the open file. He's not very much happy and satisfied with his move. He's saying exactly the move that you just suggested, only in a different way. Why not to play immediately this move? This looks very strong, especially using the fact that the pawns are on b6 and c5, and white is just much better. So, it was actually very, very nice that quite quickly, thanks to the gentleman here, quite quickly we have, well, the idea of improving the knight, and especially the knight on c4, looks just such a beautiful spot for that knight. Okay, I said it wasn't Mr. Stillman that invented those ideas. Let's see a more updated example for this one. And then we can see, well, I think two of the greatest classical ones that involve with this idea. Okay, this is a game played in the Sofia tournament. If I'm not mistaken, Ivanchuk started with 5 out of 5 there. It's a double round robin tournament, like just insane. He finished with 8 out of 10, but started with 5 out of 5. Okay. So now it's going to be maybe easier to think about how the game went. Well, what does white want to play here? If it's white to play, white wants to play very simply. Bishop d3, maybe castle, f5.
Bishop takes
b5. Yeah, at some point, I mean, bishop takes b5, but from positional point of view, let's say we can protect the pawn. No? What should be Black's long-term idea? Something to be done here.
Last idea, maybe.
Yeah.
Are we at another thing of improving the knight?
This is what we're going to do today, but improving the knight, and to where and how?
Well, we could go back to d7, which at least gets it, you know, aiming more toward the middle of the board.
But then what? Knight d7 was played. All right.
Okay.
All right. Rook a2, defending the pawn. Doesn't want to give the pawn there for free. Queen c5. I will take. I'll play queen take. Okay, let's look at queen c5. Queen c5, take, then what?
Rook take.
All right, I'll bring the king. Now I'm threatening, I think, b4 and take on b5. Okay. I'll play here. I don't know, let this rook stay here. Maybe I'll play just bishop d3. You know what? Let me move this one. I don't need it there. I'll play bishop d3 next move. The reason why I played it, I didn't even want to allow this possibility before. Although it was possible to take on b4. But I'll just play this, bishop d3, and then maybe start pushing, if possible, slowly on the king side. Maybe black is okay here, but Ivanchuk, I think white should be better. Ivanchuk had a more impressive idea. knight b8, because it's not only improving our piece, right? We want to kick that queen from d4. That's excellent. The pawn on b5, of course, cannot be taken, right?
Yeah.
Queen a5. Let's just be clear about that. This is it. Okay, castle. So, you know, it was a bit easier, you know, just to have a kick the knight a bit from b6 to c6 instead of playing three moves. So, in those three moves, what happened? The knight that was completely blocked is now aiming and controlling the dark squares in the center. Well, the rest of the game is, in our view, less important. Queen b6 to kick the king. The a3 pawn now is a target. C2 is much weaker in view of some. Knight b4 is a threat. Knight d4 is a threat. Take, take, okay. Now knight to b4 is an immediate threat. What to do? The move that we had seen before, and the a3 pawn is gone. Well, black is better, and Ivanchuk went to win. Yes? And knight to d4 at which moment?
Right.
Yeah, but do you have a direct threat here?
Yeah.
Bishop d3, and then what? But you cannot take right now. The rook on c8 is undefended, right? But I think even, I mean, I think Ivanchuk just took this pawn immediately, and oh, c2 is really weak. I mean, if c3 now, he's going to play knight a2 and he's attacking both of them. If c4, I think he's just going to, well, he didn't even take. That's even more impressive. If take, maybe take on d5. If knight take, bishop c4. And if pawn take, well, he doesn't want to allow. No, this is actually, can be some decent counterplay in some situations. Okay, we have to obviously start calculating a lot, but I think Ivanchuk, okay, let's see. He played rook a5, didn't even want to allow this. F5. No, it's amazing, the bishop is kind of trapped. Sorry. G4, okay. Bottom line somehow went and won this game. That's not our important part here. This bishop is not really that great here, and no squares for the rooks to come. Well, if we are already here, let's finish this. King to e7, pushing the pawn. Yeah, I think I remember they had like insane time trouble here. At least Topalov. And yeah, actually here just rook a1 is an idea. But the most important part, you know, is not exactly how to win the a3 pawn or the c2 pawn. It is that part that we see this knight on b6. And we have to ask a question, you know, what should we do in the position? You know, there is this principle, I forgot the name of the one that, you know, behind it. But it basically says something very simple. If you don't have any concrete plan, you don't have any concrete plan, no captures, no attacking the king, no attacking a weakness, nothing immediately, then improve your worst piece. Just very, very simple. Improve your worst piece. That's the best thing you can do. Well, b6 is definitely the one that's doing nothing. The queen is on the open file, the rook is on the open file, the a rook is on the open file. Just improve your worst piece. That's the piece on b6. That's what Ivanchuk did. Now, let's go to see, well, two of my favorite examples. I mean, well, they are just, you can't get any more classical examples than this. Let's first of all see the first one. And that is, Karpov against Spassky from the Candidates match. I believe this was the quarterfinal, I think, of the Candidate matches in 1974. And I think Karpov won this one, then he played Korchnoi, and he beat Korchnoi in a long match, 12.5, 11.5, and Fischer never made it to 1975 match. So basically, next match was World Championship match, and Spassky just lost the title in 1972, so it was very interesting. The former world champion playing against future world champion in this match. And it was interesting that Karpov's style was, well, at that time, I think there were no real super strong players like Karpov there. Fischer was probably the only one. All the other Russian generation, Petrosian and Smyslov, and they were already tiny, they were just getting a bit older, so he was really the player at that time. Okay, they played the most classical variation that was played in the Sicilian for many, many, many years. I mean, today, if we are looking at the Neidorf, Schwenningen, whatever you want to call it, then Bishop g5 on the sixth move, Bishop e3, those are, you know, especially Bishop e3 was the most popular in the 90s, early 2000, then Bishop g5 today is extremely, extremely popular. Okay, many lines, a6, Queen c7, we've even seen it in Anand Kasparov in the match in 95, and so on. Okay, just one other system. By the way, speaking about improving pieces, why white play knight b3 here? Well, what is the idea behind white's knight b3? Taking a piece from the center, moving it back? Exactly, because if white, black by playing bishop d7, his next move is just to take and play bishop c6, improve his piece, exactly. Knight b3, a5. Okay, we are not here to discuss theory. Plus, it's a line that I think very rarely we see today. Bishop f3, bishop c6, knight back. Okay, what is the idea of g6? If this is being played, well, what will be the idea of this move?
Knight h5.
I have bishop on
f3.
And then what? I would say simply, he wants to play e5 and not allowing knight f5. Right? It's like simple ideas. Usually the simple way, the most direct way, is the one that you will find to be the right one. Rook f2, okay. e5, take. Now, how to take here? With the pawn. Why with the pawn?
Because my knight has a good outpost.
That's one reason. What's another one?
And I'm connecting on
okay, and mainly controlling with square. I think this outpost for the knight, okay, it's good and so on, but I think that I would like to take with the pawn mainly because I want to be able to control the important d5 square. No, taking with the knight will leave the d6 pawn so weak, and it happens sometimes, but not exactly in those structures. Karpov took. I think one of the reasons he doesn't want black himself to take on f4 and then play d5. Right, for example, if we give black a move, let's play this ridiculous move. I think black is going to be very happy in this situation. Putting our pawns on light squares, bishop c5 is an idea. No, black is just really happy here. So Karpov took, I think he played queen f1. Okay, and here came a very tricky move. What did you say? Ah, this is a question. That's a great, great question. Is knight g4 a threat by black or not? Let's say if white plays king h1, should black play knight g4 or not? I'm not certain. Because I think white has no problems giving his light color bishop. I mean, this bishop is not very impressive. Right, I mean here. It's not the greatest bishop in the world. So, if knight g4, I think white will take. But here is a very interesting point. Karpov played h3. Was he afraid of knight g4? Maybe. And maybe what I said now is just really wrong, and he doesn't want to give the bishops, and all the usual stuff about bishops in the long run, you know, 50 moves from now they will win. Maybe h3 is just a decent move. Or maybe, what is he going to play after knight d7? Ah, of course bishop g4, because he does want to exchange this. He has no problems exchanging it. Actually, very important, what black want to play now if it's black's turn? Bishop c5. Black would be very happy exchanging this bishop, because he will play bishop to c5. And then when the knight can capture, it can go to some pretty squares. Exchanging, it's very clear. Almost always, you look at any position, one player has two bishops. Almost in most positions, one bishop is good, one bishop is bad or less good, or you know, whatever. The position is totally open, they are both great. But in this position, well, you don't need to be master, not grandmaster, not future world champion to understand, okay, you know, this bishop on e3 has all the diagonals in the board, you know, from here to there. Nothing stops its way, so black will want to exchange it. So there comes bishop g4. And I remember reading somewhere that h3 was kind of like a tricky move, like thinking, oh, I'm scared of knight g4, so when knight d7, maybe, well, Spassky would underestimate this idea. h5, take, take, queen c4. Bishop h4, rook d2. Rook f1. Alrighty. Rook d8. What now? Two moves ago, yes.
He's looking at bishop c5, yeah. Attacking the queen and rook.
How?
Keep going. Here.
Oh, bishop c5.
Yeah.
I guess queen g5 will be played, right? I guess we will play this move. I don't see anything else. Ben is nodding, so I assume queen g5 is granted. Yeah. Yeah, but no, I guess it's possible to play this way. But okay, first of all, this is something I'm looking now. I can take this and put something on d4. Oh, I'll take it and just put something on d4. And you can take it, but then you will open some more diagonals. This looks okay. Yeah, rook d1, rook f1, I can also go here. And just attacking too many things. Well, probably in this position, maybe rook ad1 might make sense. But maybe rook ad1 might make sense. Probably black will just play rook d8. And it will be somewhat dangerous in some situations to change everything and take here, because the king will be left just alone. That would be just some thought. But it's an excellent point. I mean, you know, you see possibility for a skewer to win some material. You're excellent. You're very, very correct. You should mention it. Rook f1. So what here? I think you suggested a move before, right? Which move?
Knight b1.
Knight b1. And what is the idea of knight b1?
The knight goes to b2, and then more possibilities to c4 or
f2. And something else also exists there. This is one thing, what else? No, this actually what was played. That's an excellent, excellent move. And also, play c3 and kick this knight. Now, it seems shocking idea and amazing, but we will see. Actually, I'm going to ask you a question. You can actually start thinking. At least one huge line in chess, huge line, played by, I can even give you the players. Karpov played it, Spassky played it, Carlsen played it, Anand played it, everyone plays this line. No, it's a great positional line. Kamsky plays it, right? Everyone that has this base of what we see now in the line. And by Ben saying that Carlsen plays it, I know that he knows, but he also knows that I will go after him if he will say it loudly before we, yes, Ben. So this is for you for the next, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes to think which at least one line, there are several others, but at least one has this, this idea is the, basically the line, the heart of this line. So knight b1.
It's some kind of ice cream.
Okay, so the knight, f3 and c4. I will have to be honest, when I was looking at it, I thought, oh really, the knight has to go to c4, but it's actually interesting, Karpov took it the other way. Queen b7, king h2. Why king h2? Just because. Yeah, just because, exactly, you know? No, this amazingly. No, just I'll put the king there. I'm not in a rush. I don't need to do anything dramatic. This is amazing move. We are not here to discuss this, but it's just keeping more pieces for the attack. Basically, what is his idea? It's incredible. He's going to play knight d2, f3, kick the bishop, put the rook. And he wants to keep that rook for the play. I mean, because he could have... Well, he couldn't actually... Well, he could have taken, and played knight d2. Because b2 cannot be captured because of a6. But he doesn't even want to allow that.
Also, king h2 stops bishop g3.
Just, it's healthy. Just the king is healthier there. Rook f8, okay. Black wants to defend f7, maybe get the other one to d8. But this position is already really tough. It's incredible how a knight on c3 that is many times being blocked by this pawn, which is the same idea as the ice cream variation, right? White gets a pawn that blocks this knight. Bishop d8. But now it's pretty clear black is already pretty much toast here. How should we play here? What would be logical here? Where?
Rook
f2. That's possible move. Rook f2. Yeah, rook f2. Knight ake5. But knight ake5, you have to be very, very careful. Very careful. First of all, it might be winning the game. But yesterday, we were saying we have to be insanely careful when we play such move. For example, what do we see after knight e5? If take, then this is genius idea. Take, I don't know. Bishop here, king e7, rook f2, big party over there, right? But after bishop c7, it's a new game. Yeah.
Move was too good to be true.
You know, when I analyze online, I say, okay, no, so now I give Topalov bishop, now I give this. It's not mine, you know, it's like Carlsen, it's this, but, well, in our game we should be tiny bit more, I don't know, defending our material, possessive. Rook d2. Rook f2 is definitely a possible idea to double on the f-file. But I think the D file is immediately there. Bishop e7. that's not bad for the queen. Rook d7. I mean, just, it's incredible. It's not so much Kasparov style, like sacrificing an opening, but it's amazing how from positional play, really, White play very positionally, he managed to create so many tactical threats. Rook d7 winning the game, rook d8. Take. What now? The other one. Oh, we have two rooks. That's pretty, right? Look at black pieces.
Knight b8 just as good as knight b1.
I was thinking to say that, but it's incredible. Little less. Bishop c5. And now what? One more move was played in this game, I think. What he said.
I'm looking, but I can't find a move that doesn't win.
Yeah, that's actually true. I mean, probably white, other than blundering, is anything's gonna win here. But, rook which move? Which move?
Rook
d8. That's it. Right? Because if take, I always like to say, and that's so easy, right? Once you see the king, and this square is empty. Very, very scary. Very. No, okay, Spassky first of all resigned here. But he resigned because, this square is empty and everything is collapsing here. Oh, I mean, it's just checkmate or winning all the pawn or something together, right? The queen is going to take here. Maybe rook f8 is only move not to be checkmated immediately, but just take on f8, take on f6, you name it. So what happened? 10 moves ago, it looked like, okay, it's some positional battle. How did this knight got here and black position started collapsing exactly from this moment? Exactly. This was a position that you might say, okay, maybe white's a bit better, maybe not, you know. Maybe he can, maybe this pawn is weak. If I look at that, I'm saying, let's think in end game, maybe this pawn is weak. There is some pressure against f7, but black is about to exchange rooks. A white king is not the safest in the world. I mean, it's not a bad king, but I'll be happier if white had another pawn on f2. But after this move, things started to become very unpleasant for black. And he took really 10 moves. Actually, here he's already lost. So really in less than 10 moves. Okay, another one. And we have exactly the same idea. Another world champion. This was played 5 years after. We have Petrosian, world champion from 1963 till 1969. Actually lost his title in 1969 to Spassky, that we have seen before. Exactly. Playing against one of the, well, at that time, strongest Hungarian player, a member of the Olympic team for a very long time. Let's see. So, the game started with a very solid knight f3, but we are now entering, well, I would say Pirtz, modern defense, Pirtz. Okay, the very classical variation, not, you know, the four pawns or the bishop e3, four pawns, the Austrian attack. Okay, many different versions to play here. It is somewhat similar to King's Indian idea in general. Black will target the dark squares, right? He has bishop on g7, no pawn yet on e5, so he might want to take the pawn on the knight on f3 and somehow play on d4. Okay, queen d2, e5, take. Rook a d1. what does white have here? Well, maybe very, very small advantage, you know, maybe symbolic one, but his bishop looks tiny better than black's bishop, mainly the one on g7. Take the bishop on g7, put it on b6. No, white is nothing, less than nothing, much, much less than nothing. All right, queen c8, queen c1, rook d8, take, take. Okay. a6. Why a6? I think, well, some ideas of, in some lines, either knight b5 and attacking those pawns, or some lines where knight d5 will be played, and he doesn't want to leave this pawn there. I mean, okay, I will be objective. I think white is slightly better, maybe microscopically, but I think black should be more or less reasonable here. By the way, speaking about improving pieces, sometimes, by the way, exchanging pieces is the best way to improve them. How can we exchange this bishop? At least an idea. Right, that's an excellent idea. Right. Actually, we see those ideas a lot in Marozzi positions, where those ideas happen. Yeah, this is an idea. If black technically has those two moves, h5, king a7, and he will exchange this, white has zero advantage. No, nothing. But, well, it doesn't have those moves. So, here we are. Now you know what white is going to play, right? Because, well, what is the problem with knight d5? There's no problem, it's just that black is okay here. Black most likely just going to take, play knight d4. And what is his problem? No problem. So, this knight is going to move to b1. We have seen it. I played a game, I don't think it is on chess, but it's a game I played in, oh my gosh, World Championship Under 16 in 1991. Shocking. And it wasn't so much positional idea, but it was actually just to move to open a diagonal. I played this and won the game quite quickly. I took on f6 and then the knight actually joined the game. But those knight retreats, they happen so much, like in our variation, for the same purpose, to open the bishop. But there is one other main idea to move this knight. It's not just to improve it. c3. We want to kill this knight. And white has, you know, this involves a lot of positional ideas. White extra bishop, his spare bishop, is this one, which is on light color. So those pawns will, to be most effective, will have to be on opposite dark squares. Good enough for Petrosian, he also knows that. You know, who was telling me, I was analyzing with someone, he was saying, you know, you suggest a move in commentary, and then, you know, Carlsen played to Arnand, and you say, wow, look at him, he's playing like me. I don't remember who was telling me this joke. One of the ICC commentators. Oh, look. Oh, it was Yasser. Actually, our own Yasser. He was saying, yeah, I was in Princeton, I was doing commentary for the college championship, and Yasser was there with Lindenwood team, and okay, we got to hang around there a lot. Actually, the reason why I'm here is because we got to speak so much there, and somehow, you know, the idea to come to St. Louis was up there. But yeah, he said, look at him, he's playing like the move I suggested. Very nice, Magnus. All right, but for us, you know, Petrosian also knows the idea where to put the pieces. So knight b1, really, the pawns will be most effective. Why? We want to control d square, c5, d4. All the pieces will control the light squares and the knight and the other pieces, the light squares. I told you that you know the idea. All right, c3. Once again, white is better here. How do you know if one player is better? You just ask yourself a simple question and you should answer in 5 seconds. Do I want to be white or black? White or black? You know, what your instinct tells you. You want to be white here. Queen d3. Okay, and here interesting. You know, the rest of the game is tiny bit. Well, it's still very, very nice positionally to see that. But how did white play? Okay, he's not afraid to exchange pieces. You know, we had seen probably, let's say in the last decade, we have two decades. We have two players that really play those positions as comfortable as possible. Who are those players? Two. Huh? That I think, you know, like Queen B1 is like they've managed to win positions with very few pieces, just tiny better. Well, one of them is Carlsen, right? That doesn't need the pieces, it doesn't need anything, you know, just somehow to be able to push the clock and win. And Kramnik. I mean, Kramnik, I'm just having in my head now so many positions, like the endgame he won against Ilieskas. Do you know, remember this one, Ben? From Nimzo Indian. They had three minor pieces, position looks completely locked. I think it's like some Doser minus 96, some tournament like that in the middle of the, maybe Madrid 95. A bit, you know, amazing. So Queen B1, you know, to most players, well, look, well, what are they playing here? Oh, but they're going to play 1,000 more moves here. Knight is going to come to d2, bishop to e2, b4, then the king will come. Okay, black is worse.
But ultimately, though, what is so bad about black's position that white can actually win this game? I mean, I don't actually see it. I tend to play the black side of this a lot, so that's kind of trippy all
the time. By the way, another player, while you are saying that, because I'm just running some position to my head, was Anderson, Olf Anderson, right? He won some positions.
He said 20 years.
What?
Did you just say 20 years ago? Olf still plays.
He still plays. Yeah, he's still.
He's not talking about Adolf.
No.
That's
not 20 years ago. That's like 120 years ago. But some of the positions that you won were exactly like this. You know, I remember I was discussing with someone, and he says, who do you think is more difficult to play? That was interesting. Who do you think is more difficult to play? And I remember the names of the player that he mentioned. Someone like Louis Boyevich, great player, very creative, aggressive. Or someone like Anderson. And I was thinking, I was having this discussion with Yermolinsky. And I was thinking, and I said, first of all, it depends on style. But I think playing against Anderson is more difficult. Because of the reason that you mentioned. Because the depth of the ideas is... Well, it's way, way above almost everyone. It's like you look and say, hey, what's so wrong in black's position? Does black have any clear weaknesses? No. Is black king weak? No. Does black have any big problems with his structure? No. Does he have double pawns, weak pawns? No. His pieces? But he's just slightly worse. Slightly, because white has a pair of bishops. And white, and there are still pawns on both sides, and white will push the pawns, and white at some point, 20 moves from now, 30 moves from now, white might create one tiny weakness. If you ask me if I think this game is closer to a draw or to a win for white, of course it is much closer to a draw. But it is much more fun to play this with white in the long term. I mean,
probability for white,
I don't know, but you know, look, without, you put it on a computer, okay, right, wrong, you know. Yeah, I personally think it's tiny bit more than 1/10 of a pawn. I mean, I think it's a draw, but I would say I think white is tiny bit more than that.
Okay. I was just kind of curious.
No.
You're
going to
show us like a major in 5 minutes.
Exactly. Why we can see how Petrosian won it. Yes, there were queens on the board, but you know, let's imagine how this game exactly will continue without queens, and we'll see how different it will be. Okay, not one exchange. Okay, let's exchange. Let's not. Okay, so everyone was happy. Queen e6, queen d3, knight c6, a3. You see? He knows, right? He knows. He put the pawns on dark squares. He has light color bishop. He will control all those squares with this one. And those will control all the dark squares. Knight d8, oh, black is very active, right? Back forth. Okay, so now you start to at least see there are tiny bit problems here. There are some problems. He managed to, well, at least he has an attack. b5, but what is the problem with those types of moves like b5? They start to create weaknesses. Look at the thing. You are in your bunker, not going anywhere. Okay, the opponent is bringing more forces and more forces. At some point you want to play something. Well, you are exposed, you are out. So, again, I believe it's the position is much closer to a draw. But I think out of 100 games, yeah, white will win, I don't know. White will win decent amount, like, okay, 20% and should be 80% draws, maybe 60-40. I don't know. It depends on two questions. Who do you play? And, you know, today in the world, when we see what Carlsen can win, he wins positions that are ridiculously less than this. And he doesn't win them against normal grandmasters. He wins them against the best grandmasters in the world. So, no, this position is a lot already. Knight c6, queen e8. Okay, c4. When you push pawns, you create weaknesses. Knight f6, take. Take the pawn, queen here. Okay, now just take, and white is just going to win this game because of this pawn. It's just going to win the game because of this pawn. And it's actually so fascinating how he played here. b5 to cement the knight. Queen here. And here, you know, I find it just amazing, the next move that he played. You wouldn't imagine, to your question, how he would play here to win. You know, the game, I think, lasted one move, which is amazing. What was played in that one move? It's kind of funny. b8, queen d1, and so on.
If I were blitzing this out, I would have played a5, but there's also the idea of bishop a7 going to d8.
Let's think about it. a5 is, of course, the move I think is the simplest move, the most logical move to play, and probably just winning, pretty much. But, you know, how can white not win this position? Let's ask this question. How can white not win this position?
Let these people play white.
Yeah. No, white cannot win this position if he will somehow get his king in trouble. Some perpetual, some this. I think I would probably play a5.
G2.
He played queen e2. Basically, okay, no check. Now, 25-90, which is black player. Right, today, I mean, you know, you can barely get a bagel with this rating, right? I mean, and no joke. But in 1979, it was probably number 10 in the world.
A dozen bagels.
Dude, I'm so hungry. It was probably number 10 in the world, 15. Oh, Sachs was 10 in the world for a little bit. He was always an important player. I mean, they actually had an amazing, very, very strong Hungarian team with Sachs and Portis and Ribli. I mean, those were the spiritual father of all the Peter Lekos that we see and many other great Hungarian players. But queen e2, no more moves. That's it. There is no check, so you cannot do anything to the king. And if knight d4, it's just going to take. I mean, there's nothing to discuss, right? It's going to take, and now he's going to play what? One move, right? Again, we're in the same style. Yeah, it's just going to blockade it, and that's it. And that's it. Okay. Now, to your question, was it winning? No. Was white 1/10, 2/10, 3/10 better throughout the game? Yes. Critical point, just in time, he was able to prevent black from playing, putting his knight on d4 by moving the knight back and getting this pawn. Now, the idea that opening idea that we have, and then maybe just for you, because you touched a sensitive point, you know, because Anderson was, you know, one of my childhood heroes.
Sorry.
No, no, it was a great point. I will see if I can, you know, just find one game of Anderson, just to show idea, to show how to win positions that have less than nothing. But first of all, let's look at our knight retreating idea. So we have it in, obviously, in which variation? The Breyer variation, that is the most common one that we see. That, I mean, there are others. So we see this many times. When there is this pawn on c3 or pawn on c6, they are killing the knight that is in front of them. Just killing this knight. He can't go here, can't go here. This knight pretty much has to go somewhere. So either in the, I think the name of this is Zaitsev, right? I think Karpov variation, Zaitsev was the second. I think that's the name Chigorin, or obviously our Breyer variation that's being played by really, really everyone. So similar maneuvers to what we have seen before, the knight goes from b8 to d7, and the bishop will follow on b7, and like we said, this is a line being played by everyone these days. So the idea of improving pieces in the middle game, and this is very bizarre, right? We are in the opening. We just played knight c6, I don't know, second move, and now move 9, already moving the knight again, just to improve its spot.